Welcome to our new season. Hopefully we will have more various interesting talks on philosophy in general and philosophy of science in particular. And I hope that my talk, which I prepared for today, is a proper talk to start this season, because the theme of this talk is devoted to understanding of what is specifically science, what specifically has been invented, was invented in 17th century, which later got this term science. And the focus which I'm going to use to look at science at my talk of today is set by Joseph Needham, who was a famous biochemist and also embryologist of the last century and sinologist. His years of life, 1900-1995. And he was, as I'm saying, famous biochemist, embryologist, and sinologist. The Needham Research Institute, devoted to the study of China's scientific history, was opened in 1985 by Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. In his middle age, I would say close to 40, some important question appeared in front of his mental eyes, which he formulated very clearly. And then this question actually formed the second part of his life. We may say, quoting him, that the rest of his life, like almost 50 years after he formulated this question, was devoted to answers, all possible answers to these questions. And he became sinologist because of this very question. The question is this, quote of Joseph Needham: "Why did modern science, the mathematization of hypotheses about nature, with all its implications for advanced technology, take its meteoric rise only in the West at the time of Galileo? Why modern science had not developed in Chinese civilization, which for centuries was much more efficient than Occidental in applying human natural knowledge to practical human needs?" Question. This is a question of Joseph Needham. The same question, end of quote, the same question can be asked about late antiquity, say post-Archimedean antiquity. Why did it essentially stop or almost stop? Eastern Roman Empire, medieval time, India, Muslim world, at least after golden age of Islam, late start of Russia. Why only West played such important role, Western civilization became the motherland of science and for centuries nurtured science, and only West nurtured science for centuries. Before proceeding, I'd like to make a disclaimer. The consideration of this Joseph Needham question may easily become politically incorrect. So it is a dangerous question. Some people could be offended. I would like to do my best to prevent it. I do not want to offend people of India, people of Russia, people of China, atheists maybe, or maybe some Christian people. I do not want to offend anybody. And I would like to be sort of to proceed in my consideration, in my approach to Needham question, as objectively as I can, to be completely detached with my own beliefs and preferences, to work as objective historian. And if I fail, consider this, if I will still sound offensive, just at the very beginning, I'd like to ask you to excuse me in this. But to understand the truth, we have to be ready to ask dangerous questions. Questions which can easily become politically incorrect and offensive. So this is actually the challenge of philosophical and historian truth. It is dangerous. So, here you see portraits of whom I call fathers of science of 17th century, Copernicus, Galileo, Kepler, Descartes, Newton. And I am asking the question, what did they specifically invent, which later had been named modern science? We using term science, assuming that we understand what it is. Working in a scientific laboratory, obviously we should be very well aware what science is. But not necessarily. It is easy to work in a scientific laboratory, to apply science and to work on science all your life, but do not clearly explicate what actually science is. And moreover, do not be able clearly explicate what specifically has been invented in 17th century. So my approach to Needham question is following. For today, I am going to answer this sub-question number one, which is formulated here. What was specifically invented? And try to disentangle all the important points, to explicate everything implied, to name all the specific components of science which has been invented at that time. And then, after this work is done, after all the specific components hopefully properly named and disentangled and explicated, then I think I would be able to answer the Needham question for other civilizations. What prevented China, what prevented India, what prevented Russia and other countries and civilizations for at least joining the West? Why they did not join, at least, or did not join for centuries? So here you may see some books, very few of them. Of course, there are many books devoted to scientific revolution of 17th century. This is my subjective choice. And some of the authors are very famous. Some of the authors are just authors whom I specifically like so very, very much, maybe not that well-known. And I, to a certain degree, I agree with some of the authors. Maybe disagree with them and others. So it's just an example of my little part of my shelf I think important or interesting books on philosophy of science. I would not stop here, but you see the name Bertrand Russell, Stanley Yaki, Alexander Coiré, Steven Weinberg, Demetrios Nikolaidis, Kitty Ferguson, Stephen Barr, David Wooten. Some of them are rather old. Of the last century, like Alexander Coiré, it's just middle of the last century. Some of them are very fresh, like David Wooten. In the maybe couple of issues ago of Physics Today, this book received good annotation in the journal. And Steven Weinberg, you know, it's famous physicist. Stanley Yaki is a religious thinker who's showing how science and religion go together. And Alexander Coiré, I think it was him who suggested, who coined the term scientific revolution for 17th century. I may be wrong, but I think it is true. Kitty Ferguson is my favorite author on Pythagoreanism. And I, for all this talk, I benefited a lot with discussion of this historian of physics and physicist of Boston University, my friend Gennady Gorelik, who has his own blogs, and he actually has a blog in Scientific American, and one of the articles in Scientific American of him exactly devoted to the Needham question, how the modern physics was invented in 17th century. So I am thankful to him with long discussions on the issue and using his deep knowledge of history of science. Let me start from my favorite citations, just to for you to have a feeling of the main ideas, how they were expressed by fathers of science in 17th centuries. I would like for you to feel the original words, not just to impose on you my favorite schemes. So Galileo, 1564, 1642 years of life. Philosophy is written in this grand book, which stands continually open before our eyes, I say the universe, which cannot be understood without first learning to comprehend the language and know the characters as it is written. It is written in the mathematical language, and its characters are triangles, circles, and other geometric figures, without which it is impossible to humanity understand a word. Without this, one is wandering in a dark labyrinth. This is a book, it's called Saggiatore in Italian, it's a year, 1623. And here you may be surprised by the word philosophy, that philosophy is written in the language of geometrical figures. Of course, he means in all this book, when he's using philosophy, he means natural philosophy, which later is called physics. This is a very important statement. Maybe this statement you heard many times. It's one of the most well-known. Another quote. The same experiment, which at first glance seemed to show one thing, when more carefully examined, assures us of the contrary. This is a very important statement. We know it very well, that it takes very sharp analysis, and it is easy to make a mistake in analysis of experiment. It's not proper, false conclusion from the experiment. But at that time, it was not so clear. And for empiricists, for empirical approach to reality, this is something against them, against simplified empiricism. Just make experiment and try what happens, and that's it. So he is telling that it is high art and it requires a deep thinking and understanding this hidden language to make a proper conclusion from observation. The observation can easily fool us. One more quote. I do not feel obliged to believe that the same God who has endowed us with senses, reason, and intellect has intended us to forgo their use and by some other means to give us knowledge which we can attain by them. 1615. And one more important quotation from Galileo. This I like. This is Kazakhstan postal stamp with Galileo. From Dialogo. I know perfectly well that the Pythagoreans had the highest esteem for the science of number, and that Plato himself admired the human intellect and believed that it participates in divinity solely because it is able to understand the nature of numbers. Very bold statement, I think. And I myself am well inclined to make the same judgment. So participates in divinity. Human intellect participates in divinity solely because it is able to understand the nature of numbers. To participate in divinity is communion, is a goal of all religions, to participate in divinity, to be together with God, with all different descriptions and ideas about God. Still, even the word religion means restoration of connection with God, religio, ligaments, which we use as the same root. So communion and religion, it's the same word of participation in divinity. And he's saying that so human intellect participates in divinity solely because it is able to understand the nature of numbers. It's a very strong statement. I think it would be a mistake to interpret that Galileo sees this Pythagorean, as I would call it, Pythagorean communion with God, the only communion which man may have. He was a Christian, he was Catholic. So, of course, he accepted conventional Catholic communion with God. But he's saying about human intellect. Human intellect. The way of the intellect to have communion with God is to understand the nature of numbers.
Is it clear that he really was a Catholic? I mean, back then, I think if you said you weren't, you might be killed. So
he was Catholic.
He was Catholic. Okay. He has two daughters, both nuns. Okay. Both of his daughters were nuns. Now I'd like to share with you not less important citations from another father of science, René Descartes, 1596, 1650. The long change the long chains of simple and easy reasonings by means of which geometers are accustomed to reach the conclusions of their most difficult demonstrations had led me to imagine that all things to the knowledge of which man is competent are mutually connected in the same way, and that there is nothing so far removed from us as to be beyond our reach, or so hidden that we cannot discover it, provided only we abstain from accepting the false for the true and always preserve in our thoughts the order necessary for the deduction of one truth from another. This is his discourse on the method, 1614. Again, you see the power of mathematics expressed here. As later Spinoza actually expressed, one of the famous ideas of Spinoza, exactly rephrasing this, order of connectio of things is order of connectio of thoughts, of proper thoughts, of course, of true thoughts. One more quotation from Descartes. When I imagine a triangle, although there is not perhaps and never was in any place in the universe apart from my thought one such figure, it remains true nevertheless that this figure possesses a certain determinate nature, form, or essence, which is immutable and eternal, and not framed by me, nor in any degree dependent on my thought. This is Meditation 1641. This statement is, so, if to read it again, maybe it will be clear, that this statement is paradoxical. First, at first part of this statement, he assumes that a hypothesis that maybe this triangle, perfect triangle, exists only in his own thought. Look. Although there is not perhaps, and never was in any place in the universe apart from my thought one such figure. Maybe only my thought is a place where my mental eyes may see this triangle. But on the second part of the statement, he's saying that this figure, triangle, is eternal. It does not, for his thought, not framed by him, nor in any degree dependent on his thought. So this paradoxical statement of Descartes could be properly understood in the context of the statement. The context of the statement when he is coming from his famous cogito ergo sum, when that he is the thinking being inside him, the thought of and thought which realizes its existence, and then he is asking about external. Does anything external to his thought exist? And first, what he sees, not physical world, but mathematical objects with all their perfection. And then he sees this perfection of mathematical objects and their clear eternity tells him that something external exists, at least mathematical images. And then the next step of this, he formulates his famous proof of God existence, because divine mind is mind which generated these perfect figures, because not human mind, they have all the features of perfection. And this is a part of his proof of God existence. Descartes proved God existence through mathematics. It was very important part, segment of this proof. So, but this is also very Platonic. He actually realizes that mathematical objects, the ideal objects, which are mentally seen by mental eyes, but not invented by humans. They do exist eternally by themselves. In my opinion, all things in nature occur mathematically, 1640. So you see again in Descartes, maybe in more details than in Galileo, the description of what actually mathematics is, and again, strong belief that the natural world can be and should be expressed mathematically. And this was actually old belief. This belief is Pythagorean. All things are numbers. This is Pythagorean statement, famous Pythagorean statement. And no surprise that both Galileo and Descartes, they were Platonics. And Platonism was actually continuation of Pythagoreanism. And at that and their epoch, they discussed with Aristotelian philosophers, or peripatetics, as they called them, as followers of Aristotle, who did not believe that the world can be expressed properly by means of mathematics. And now we know very well the power of mathematics. This very laboratory is devoted to theoretical physics and to physics, and physics is expressed in the language of mathematics. But at that time, it was not that clear. And if you will look at the world, forgetting about theoretical physics and all the success of physics after that epoch, look at the trees, on the stones, on the clouds, it's not that obvious that mathematics is proper language to describe nature. Nature is not quite mathematical, I would say, at first glance. And it has a reasonable people, or philosophers with more accent on common sense, they did not believe that mathematics is a proper language to describe nature. In trees, or in stones, or in soil, or in birds, in animals, in human beings, not that many mathematical. Of course, we may count stones, we may count ships, we may count planets, but counting is not that language which they meant. It was not, when they expressed this belief in mathematics, they did not say that we may count things. They believed that nature can be expressed and essentially caught in the system of thinking, like Euclidean geometry, with axioms and theorems. That's what they meant. And this has nothing to do with counting. It's much more than that. One more quotation from Descartes. Finally, if there be still persons who are not sufficiently persuaded of the existence of God and of the soul by the reasons I have adduced, I am desirous that they should know that all the other propositions, of the truth of which they deem themselves perhaps more assured, as that we have a body and that there exist stars and an earth and such like, are less certain. Less certain. This is a part of Cartesian consideration of the meaning of God for knowledge. Without God as a guarantor of truth. Without God, we may be not sure in anything. That's I'm not going to go into details of this. I'm addressing the main articles of Descartes. They are brilliantly written, and it's a special pleasure to read them, his meditations and his discourse. And one more statement, very important, which sheds light on the previous. God cannot be a deceiver, since fraud and deception necessarily proceed from some defect. And he's proving God's existence from mathematical objects, that some perfect mind should stay behind these mathematical objects, such these Platonic forms, and this perfect mind, absolute mind, is mind of God, and then, since it is perfect, it cannot be a deceiver, because fraud and deception necessarily proceed from some defect. Now, after these citations, I'd like to start to explicate and to name what is implied here, and the most important point of these quotations, which I shared with you. So let's focus on one of the most famous of those statements and ask about its explicit and implicit meanings. Now I am taking just a little bit rephrased and condensed famous statement of Galileo. The grand book of the universe is written in the language of mathematics. It stands continually open before our eyes. Without knowledge of this language, one is wandering in a dark labyrinth. And I would explicate what is implied here. So first, you see the statement expressed in a powerful poetry, powerful images, grand book of the universe, and dark labyrinth. You see that, what poetry, why did he use this poetry? What does it mean? Whenever you see the powerful language of powerful poetry, it always signifies powerful meaning, high importance of the statement. It was written in the scientific book, in some polemical book, the SAE. And But this statement stands alone. So this powerful poetry signifies in very high importance of what was said. So the image of this grand book, the grand book of universe, the book of the epoch is, of course, Bible. And for him, and in the spirit of time, of course, this book was some condensation of the most important, valuable things. So when he compares the universe to the Bible, he actually implies the extreme importance and goodness of the universe. That the universe is not something second-rate thing. That the material world is essentially good. So this is already implied in this image of grand book of the universe. It's deep, and then its deep understanding is of extreme importance and value, as it is for deep understanding of Bible. So the parallel of Bible and the universe is implied here. This understanding is possible for humans. It is also implied here. So he's saying, without knowledge of this language, one is wandering in a dark labyrinth. It is implied that one not doomed to be wandering in a dark labyrinth. It is possible to see the light and to increase the light and to see better and better. So it is very optimistic statement, actually. Mathematics is the language of the grand book. Again, mathematics receives very high significance in this context. It is a divine language. It is the language of God. Inasmuch as humans learn that language, they see the related part of the grand book as clear as its author. This is also Galileo in other places, he clearly stated that the difference between divine mind and human mind is that God sees everything. But as soon as I see these mathematical forms which are used for this for the book, I see as clearly as God sees, because mathematical forms are absolutely clear. There is nothing hidden behind of them. So again, this is specific communion. After I tried to make these explications of what implied there, I would like to ask a question. Didn't we miss anything that important there? Maybe something is still missed? Well, what was meant by mathematics? I think that the quotation of Descartes, which I am not going to repeat, saving time, but here on the slide you see the same quotation which I already read, and I think it is a definition of mathematics, where Descartes expressed in more details what I think Galileo implied. So I'm not going to read again the same statement, but I'd like just to make explications from the Descartes statements, Descartes' definition about mathematics, description of mathematics. Mathematics is much more than just a knowledge about figures and numbers. This is very important to understand. Layman people normally do not understand it. Many people think that mathematics is just knowledge about numbers and figures. That's not true, of course, because in that respect, as knowledge about numbers and figures, this knowledge existed thousands of years before Euclid. But mathematics, as a very special way of thinking, was invented by Platonic schools and was perfectly implemented by Euclid. I think received its perfect expression, what it is. It is a very special way of thinking. What is specific for this way of thinking? With absolute certainty and universality, potentially unlimited number of clear and distinctive statements, theorems, can be proved or refuted. This is the power of mathematics. It's not just knowledge of what is true about numbers and what is wrong. No, it is a way to generate potentially infinite number of statements, clearly prove or refute them, and universally, independently on your or mine special cultural or human preferences. Mathematics belongs to universal reason. This thinking is detached from all specific cultural or even biological features of humans. Thus, it belongs to the universal absolute reason, to the mind of God. Thus, mathematics is a participation in the divinity, a specific Pythagorean communion. Since the creator is a perfect master and artist, only beautiful mathematical forms have to be expected as the world axioms or the laws of nature. The laws of nature, the very term laws of nature, also was suggested by Galileo. First, not in his books though, but in his in his letter exchange. Unfortunately, I do not remember in which specific letter, but this letter became known. And then this idea was supported, the term laws of nature was supported by Descartes and used by Newton. Essentially, Newton made it publicly accepted, but it started by Galileo. So I think this is the answer what mathematics is. Are we still missing any? You have a question, Leo?
Yes, go back.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you disconnected from figures and numbers, groups,
Ah, no, I'm talking about that time. I'm trying to explicate what Galileo and Descartes thought. I'm not describing mathematics from our position or from any objective position. I'm trying to understand how did
right.
they think.
So, from this, I get the impression what you're saying is that the important thing was that you had this way of getting and demonstrating complicated propositions from simpler propositions and doing it in a clearer, universal manner. So in that sense, is this definition different from just logic?
Yes, Mike.
This is a good question.
I mean, in logic, you're limited by like Boolean, basically.
No, let's think historically. I'm suggesting to think historically.
I was trying to say that Galileo, he was thinking also about geometry, like triangle and other.
Boolean algebra didn't exist at that time.
Yeah, but I mean, he didn't really thought in terms of like truth or false. He also.
So for them, logic, as Aristotelian logic, I think was an example of clear and distinctive thinking. But still it was not, they considered that mathematics and logic should be combined together. While for Aristotelian philosophers, logic was sufficient. For Galileo and Descartes and then Newton, logic was not sufficient. Mathematics and grammar should be taken into account. And of course, logic together. So this was a contradiction between Aristotelians and Platonics of that epoch. Platonics insisted on figures and numbers as important. Aristotelians insisted on logic and common sense. So logic was accepted by everybody. So that is what, at that epoch of this intellectual elite people. So the discussion was against figures and numbers. Are we still missing anything? I think yes. One more important point still remains to be said. On which ground did he conclude all this? How he can be sure that the language at which written the Book of Nature, mathematics, and so on, where this belief is coming from? Why they were so? Where did he take all the audacity required by these ultimate statements, power of this prophecy about world, man, and God? They were absolutely sure. They stated it without no doubt, as a matter of faith. Why was his prophecy supported by inspired followers? Those are very important questions which we also have to try to address. To understand this point, we have to remember that fathers of science were people of Renaissance and Reformation epochs. They learned from ancient Greeks the power of reason, the fascinating perfection of mathematics, boldness of cosmological ideas. All this they knew from Greeks. They learned from the Bible that they are sons of God, who is the author of everything. They knew that everything he created was very good. they learn to trust and love him. These statements are also very important. On that basis, they saw as their duty to establish a synthesis of all the wisdom they inherited. They were audacious enough to believe that they can do that, and gingerly enough to know how easy to make a mistake. So, to demonstrate you a little bit more about this fascinating epoch, I'd like to share with you quotations with some other person, Giovanni Pico della Mirandola, who belonged to the circle of Florentine humanists and one of the brightest stars of Renaissance, and who was born about 100 years before Galileo, just to feel the spirit of the time. How audacious was this spirit, how powerful it was. Now from Pico della Mirandola, his years of life, 1463-1494, just 31, he was poisoned at 31. The Supreme Father, from his well-known paper, which is called Oration on the Dignity of Man, 1486. So he was, 23 years old at that time.
This is a picture of a man?
Man, yes. Okay. Yes. Sort of feminine face, I also impressed, but he is very bold, very audacious, very powerful, and this is such in concert with his feminine face. He's extremely, one of the extremely powerful person of Renaissance. So quotation of the dignity of man. The Supreme Father, God the Architect, had already built the cosmic home we behold, the most sacred temple of divinity, according to the laws of the mysterious wisdom. But when the work was finished, the craftsman still longed that there was someone to ponder the meaning of so great a work, to love its beauty, and to wonder at its vastness. He therefore took man, this creature of indeterminate image, set him in the middle of the world, and thus spoke to him. God is speaking to man. Quote, God speaking. We have given you, Adam, no fixed seat, no features proper to yourself, no endowment peculiar to you alone, in order that whatever seat, whatever features, whatever endowment you may responsibly desire, this same you may have and possess according to your desire and judgment. It will be in your power to degenerate into the lower forms of life, which are brutish. You shall have the power, according to your soul's judgment, to be reborn into the higher orders, which are divine. And one more quotation from this paper, from this article, Oration. If man cultivates his vegetable seeds, God provided man with all sorts of seeds, and then the freedom of man to cherish one sort of seed or another sort of seed. So vegetable seeds, lower sort of seeds. If man cultivates his vegetable seeds, he will become a plant. If he cultivates his sensible seeds, he will become brutish. If he cultivates his rational seeds, he will become a heavenly animal. If he cultivates his intellectual seeds, he will be an angel and the son of God in the next life. So this very bold statement said by this very young man, Giovanni Pico della Mirandola, and he then suggested to discuss it. He wrote 900 theses and sent it, tried to publish it, never published, but sent it to some friends. And then he even wanted to pay for philosophers to come to his city, I guess in Florence, maybe in Ferrara. Sorry, I forgot this. He was a son of rather rich parents. So he had intention to pay travel expenses for philosophers to come and discuss all his 900 points. So you see, I hope you see a little bit better the spirit of time, which Galileo actually inherited. Although it is 100 years between Pico della Mirandola and Galileo, it was still the power of this audacious spirit was still in the air.
Alexey, why was he poisoned? Because of philosophical?
No, because of political, I think. He was poisoned. It's not quite clear, but the leading idea of historians that he was poisoned by Piero de Medici at time of Savonarola, and Pico supported Savonarola, and he was at that time, and Piero intrigued to come to power and to make the political power of Savonarola party, which Pico supported, diminish. So he and his friend, I forgot the name of his friend, they were poisoned at the same day, and then relatively recently, their bodies were exhumated and analyzed, and poison arsenic.
Arsenic
was found there. Yes, and the idea of, although I don't think it is completely proven, but the leading dominant idea of historians that he was poisoned by Piero de Medici by the he was not a son of Lorenzo de' Medici, but he was a son of his brother, I believe. Lorenzo supported very much Pico della Mirandola, the uncle of Piero de' Medici, Lorenzo Magnifico. He supported Pico, but Piero poisoned him. So this was the turmoil of the epoch, but by political reason, not by philosophical. so let me just pronounce the features of audacious spirit of that time. What makes the spirit of this time so powerful? I'd like to again to explicate some important points which I see contributed to this power. First, medieval Western pluralism, which visits significant freedom. Contemporary people have an idea that at that time of Renaissance and even medieval time, freedom was very low. Of course, if to compare with contemporary freedom, of course, there were much more limitations to freedom of speech and so on. But if you will compare with other civilizations, you will see that the freedom was very powerful actually at that time. You may actually feel it from the statement, for instance, of Pico, which I showed you. Universities with their universal thought and special freedoms. At that time, the universities were actually supported by church, organized and nourished by church, with their intellectual debates, it was a normal thing. And students had the privileges of clergy. Actually, they enjoyed all these privileges, which were very important, of course. They shared the religion of perfection. Christianity was a religion of perfection. It was not a religion of stable state, religion of obedience. Of course, you may find a lot of religion of obedience in Christianity, but Christianity is not only a religion of obedience, it is a religion of perfection. Man is an image and similarity of God. It's a very powerful statement. Therefore, you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. As you know, this is it's Christ's statement. You have to be perfect. Perfection is a will of God about man to become, to move further and further in perfection. Remember also the parable of talents. This is one of the most important statements. You have to increase the talents. God gave you talents, you have to use them and make from one talent 2, 3, or 5, or 10. If you just preserve your talent and did not bring more talents from this one, you are going to be punished. Talents are given not just in vain. They are given for you to nourish them. God became man for man to ascend to God. Original sin was considered as what has to be and can be overcome with the help of God, of course, and maybe mainly by means of God. But your own efforts are very important. Freedom of will, the idea of freedom of will was very important. Return of the ancient texts and the necessity of the new synthesis was also very a feature of that time. This circle of Florentine humanists, they did a lot of translation of these texts, bringing them to them to public. And existence of religious texts, proper Christian texts, and ancient Greek texts of Plato, Plotinus, and so on, returning to the West, made the collision of the two sets of ideas. And top intellectuals of the epoch considered this as a problem for them, for the new synthesis. This was a problem of Florentine humanists and those who inherited them.
What was the problem?
To make a new synthesis of Greek wisdom and Christian wisdom.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Although Christianity itself inherited Greek thought, but they saw the necessity of new synthesis. Gutenberg Press, also very important, 1450, made books available for the middle class. Before, books belonged to very few people because it was very expensive to pay. You know, monk has to write, a very qualified monk has to write maybe for a year or so to make a book. Now, with the Gutenberg Press, you may have texts, at least Bible. You may have almost every family, at least upper middle class or maybe middle class, may have the Bible to read and understand it itself. And Reformation, now one more important idea of the epoch, Reformation connected salvation with personal efforts in the Bible studies. Sola Scriptura was made associated with the sola fide. This is a very important point of Protestant, of Reformation. But the ideas did not know the borders. Although Galileo belonged to Catholic world, he was not a Protestant. But the idea was everywhere. And the necessity to read and understand Bible, to understand, not only the book of nature has to be understood. Of course, the book which God gave to people to understand what is good and bad, the Bible have to be understood personally.
Are you going to translate Sola Scriptura?
Yes. Sola Scriptura is soul only by scripture, and sola fide only by faith. Thus the meaning of life got a strong personal, spiritual, and historical unfolding accent. This is the audacious spirit of time. This, I think, how it made possible. So if I will try to combine all the important features which Galileo, Descartes, Kepler, Newton combined, synthesized in new natural philosophy or new science, I think I can separate them in three big groups. First, inheritance from Greek, Pythagorean ideas, Pythagoreanism and Platonism, all things are numbers. These forms, eternal forms, which actually form our world, intelligible forms, Platonic. Then this is one source of new synthesis, of Galilean and Cartesian synthesis of science. Another source is Bible, is this belief in the cognition of science, in the cognition of nature, as a special communion with God, possible and important. And the third source is a freedom, is a specific freedom of that epoch, this audacious spirit of time. I think these three, although they somehow connected and there are common features between them, there are some certain common features between Pythagoreanism and Christianity, but still every one of them has something important to add. For instance, if you will consider only Pythagoreanism and Bible, or Platonism and Bible, the two existed in the Eastern Roman Empire, but Eastern Roman Empire lost its freedom of thought. And so this freedom of thought was lost, and that is why Eastern Roman Empire stopped, I think. This main reason, I think, why this state and these people who inherited all the treasures of antiquity, they essentially died when they were alive and did not produce anything valuable for centuries or very few. So this is my conclusion and the end of my talk for today about
the most important features of revolution of the 17th century. Why it was possible? What constituents came into synthesis of Galileo and Descartes? Every specific part of this synthesis existed before. They did not bring any special before them and in other cultures also. But all together, I think they existed only in the West. So all these features which I tried to mention and to enlist, they fortunately existed at 17th century in the Western civilization. And these great people did the synthesis of them. Although every specific component, ingredient of this synthesis was much older, but altogether they came only at this specific time, in this specific place of human oikoumena. So I think now, after I enlisted all these components, I prepared the second part of my talk, which will be much shorter, I think, to consider Needham question, to come back to Needham question and to answer what of this specific component did not exist in one or another place and time, epoch, civilization, which prevented the synthesis not only to be made, but even to follow. They were not able to follow. Or it was very hard to follow, took centuries to start to follow. So, but this would be the second part of my talk, much shorter. So I think that our next meeting in September, in 2 weeks, in September 22, in the same room, I will spend like 15 minutes, very briefly, without going into details, just pointing my own hypothesis, what was lost, or what not lost, but what ingredient did not exist in China, in India, different ingredient. All the answers will be different. One thing did not exist in China, another thing did not exist in India, one more thing did not exist in Russia for a very long time before Russia started to catch up. Or in late antiquity, I already mentioned Eastern Roman Empire. And then September 22, I would like to hear each of you who would like to express his or her opinion about Needham question. So I will finish my answer to Needham question on September 22 in first 15 minutes, I think, of my talk. Thank you so much. And now we still have some time. For discussion, but mostly again, I hope we will discuss September 22, but still, we have some time for today.
One provocative thing. Yes, Western civilization produced science, conceived sciences, that is, mathematized science. China didn't produce, India didn't produce, but do they need it innerly in their culture? Maybe don't need it. Oh, why do we need this science for atomic bomb, for ecology crisis?
This is a question of value of science. This question of value of science. Do somebody need science or not is a question for everybody. So you yourself may have very powerful value of science, I believe, but somebody else maybe not. Somebody else is free to see in science more dark sides like atomic bomb or ecological problems. But I think at least even for those who considers more dark sides in scientific and technological progress should be honest. And if you see more dark sides, you would be rather stay aside from the progress and live in the forest somewhere. Then I would be ready to discuss the negative part of science with somebody who lives like a forest guru and teaches there in the forest, do not enjoy the benefits of technological progress. This person, that sort of person, could be taken seriously. But if somebody enjoying in full scale the benefits of progress and still has a expressing the negative ideas about science, I think this is at least not honest position.
No, that's not completely true, because this scientific things, they penetrated all the cultures. They invaded Indian, Chinese culture, everywhere. Well, even if you go to China, you will find there the same technology.
Well, they benefited from science, though, as you're saying. If you use indoor toilets, you benefited from scientific invention. Or if you use aspirin to cure a headache, you benefited from science.
That's one such
or not. Yeah, so I think that's what you're saying.
You benefit, so you should be detached. To be honest, you should detach. If you're detaching, I'm ready to discuss. Or at least you're making an effort to detach. Serious effort. Maybe you're not able to detach completely, but at least if you're making serious effort to detach. About India or China, did they need it? I would say that maybe in India, ancient Indians and medieval Indians, they had all the possibilities to invent at least pure mathematics. Why did not do this and did not follow? I think because they really did not need this. Pure mathematics. And physics, I don't think that they were able to invent. I will tell why my opinion about this next time.